pleasure to have Yanni Kondev here from Brandeis. Got his degree, his undergraduate degree in Belgrade, and his PhD from Cornell. He spent a few years at Brown as a postdoc, and then the Institute and the Physics Department at Princeton, which is where I first met him. Nice. And since then, he's been at Brandeis, and he does work in biophysics. He's written this book with Rob Phillips and Julian Curio, which is sort of a standard textbook, I should say, for biophysics. And he works on gene expression, on packing of DNA. He's going to tell us today about building a proportional set.
Thanks, Paul. Yeah, it's really great to be here. So it's really fun to be here because when I was a postdoc at Princeton at the Institute, as Paul mentioned, I was living in New York, and it was a real pain in the ass getting down to Princeton. And then I was always trying to find people I could talk to at either NYU and Columbia, and I just couldn't find anyone. That was, 20 odd years ago, and boy, has this place changed. And it's wonderful. So that's one of the reasons it's great to be here. Another, of course, is to see a lot of old friends and make some new friends, and just to get a chance to tell you a little bit about something that we started on working very recently, and I suspect there will be people in this room who know far more about this, or at least the physics aspects of this, than I do. So that was another reason why I wanted to give the talk, because I hope to get educated. Maybe Shura will tell me which paper this was all worked out in the 50s, and maybe it's even translated into English. But I can read Russian, so we're good. So that's your job, Shura. So you can't relax. So just while I'm talking, you think 1957, Lifshitz, maybe Slyozov. I don't know. We'll see. Okay, so...
this isn't really known Lifshitz, yeah.
Right. Page, whatever, right? Yeah, exactly. There's so many, lame jokes about that, which I'll skip. Okay, so what I want to tell you is this story that I got very excited about, and you'll see how I got into it a little later. But the story begins way back, and one of the first observations that actually. One of the first observations that started this story along was about looking at red blood cells and looking at nuclei in red blood cells. So that came as a surprise to me that red blood cells have nuclei, and they do. They don't have it in humans and stuff, but in other organisms they do. And the observation was that the nuclei of red blood cells would scale when you looked at these different cells. The different cells would have different sizes, and the size of the nucleus would sort of scale with the size of the cell. So there's kind of a scaling relationship. What's really fun is, this was done by a British guy whose name is Gulliver. So that's, you got to appreciate that. Right? So Gulliver was one of the people who started asking this question, and that is, what determines the size of internal structures within the cell? Okay. And one of the sort of also early experiments that happened, more than 100 years ago was this one by Conklin. So this is a developing embryo. This is some kind of a worm. Don't ask me exactly what kind. And what he did here is he centrifuged this embryo, which made it so that the two cells became inequivalent by having cytoplasms of different size. And he noticed that the cell with the bigger cytoplasm had a bigger spindle. So this is another internal structure within the cell, which the cell uses or builds in order to separate its chromosomes. Okay. So again, he noticed that somehow the cell assembled, and this structure is assembled from various components that include microtubules, among other things, and somehow the cell assembles the structure in a way that recognizes the fact that it's in a big cytoplasm versus a small cytoplasm, when it also assembles the structure but makes it smaller. So the question is, how does the cell do this? How does it, in some sense, how does it measure size? So here's some recent data about nuclear sizes. Just to, again, sort of give you a sense of the questions that people are asking. This is out of Paul Nurse's lab, which I think was while he was still at Rockefeller. But the organism here is budding, fish and yeast. And you can see the nuclei shown here. And what's interesting, I think, about this data is what you see here are various mutations that mutants of this yeast cell. And there are mutants that affect the different processes. I can't even tell you exactly, you know, it's like CDC will affect something having to do with cell cycle, but they affect different stuff going on in the yeast. And as a result of all this, the yeast cells are smaller, sometimes larger. But when you plot the volume of the nucleus versus the volume of the cell, you get this very simple scaling, right? And regardless of what you do to the yeast. So again, this kind of brings up the question, you know, does the cell, is there like a ruler in here? What is the nature of the ruler? Assuming that the cell is somehow measuring its size and accordingly adjusting the sort of the assembly of its organelle, in this case, the nucleus. So does that make sense? So we'd like to understand the mechanism. Or people, this, I think, is quite hard, or at least there's really, I think that's a hard one. So this is, of course, a very old question. You know, this is the question of scaling and size and how you build organisms that are kind of that are still viable but that are bigger versus smaller. So this comes out of a sketch of Galileo's and the way kind of he expressed. I like this. This is some translation I found, but the way he expressed this idea of scaling, which in this case, of course, as you all know, is a little different because this scaling idea here has to do with how should the shape of a bone change if you want to make an animal that's scaled up in all three dimensions, and of course, the cross section of this bone does not scale proportionally, and you work that out from the theory of beam bending. But Galileo did not work out the theory of beam bending. That came much later, presumably with Euler. But he did have this notion that he formulated in a very nice way. I believe that a little dog might carry on his back two or three dogs of the same size, where I doubt if a horse could carry even one horse of his own size. So that's Galileo's statement about how you should scale up the shape of bones in proportion to the increase in the mass of the organism to still be able to support the mass with bones before they buckle. And this again, and I'll stop here with sort of philosophy, but sort of another way that people like to think about this question is in the context of information in some sense, and that is, well, given that the blueprints of all these different cells are sort of encoded in this sequence of these bases of the DNA, what is it, or where in this sequence is it encoded, what the shape of the and the size of the cell and in different internal parts of the cell? You know, where is that information encoded? If you want, you know, if you want to think of it as a mathematician, in some sense, this is, you know, you have some kind of information about maybe the kind of protein you're making and the quality and the amount of protein you're making, but how do you, based on that, sort of specify the positioning, the shape, the size, the geometry of the cell, right? So it's kind of the old question of the R.C. Thompson's of morphogenesis or shape, you know, the generation of shape, but in the context of a single cell, that what the field is excited about, and we're just sort of my group is making baby steps in that field. Okay, so that's sort of just to kind of give you the lay of the land or give you sort of some sense of the questions that excite us, but let me try to be a little more specific and tell you about sort of the things that we're really working on, and that's filamentous structures. So a number of reasons. One is that they're kind of easy to study experimentally because now the question of size is very simple. What we're simply going to be asking is what's the length of the filament, okay? So I'll spend a lot of time later, or some time later, telling you about this system because that's the one where we're doing experiments. This is a yeast cell, and it's a budding yeast cell, so this is a daughter cell. And in the process of making a baby yeast cell, it also builds these filamentous structures. These are actin structures. These are cables that the yeast cell uses for transport. And by some trickery that we'd like to understand, the size of these filaments is exactly sort of matched to the size of the cell. Okay. Similarly, you know, there are other filamentous structures. This is one that's been studied a lot by a group at UCSF led by Wallace Marshall. So this is a single-celled it's a photosynthetic bacteria, Chlamydomonas, and it's got two flagella, which it sort of beats around in order to swim. And again, if you look at the lengths of these flagellas, their lengths are finely tuned. In other words, the size of these flagellas is very similar from cell to cell to cell to cell. If you cut one of these flagella by simply, just laser cut it, then what will happen is the bigger one will shrink, and then they'll both grow up to be the same size they started with. So there's something there that encodes the length. And so lots of beautiful experiments of this kind. We're starting to work on this. I'll show you some preliminary data from collaborators. This is an amazing structure. So this is hair cells. These are cells in the inner ear responsible for hearing. These cilia are protrusions all coming out of one cell. They're actin-based structures, and they have this beautifully sort of graded shape, graded in length cilia. And for instance, there are mutations, I'll show you later, that make all these cilia have the same length, and that leads to a certain kind of hearing loss. So people are studying this also for those reasons. And there's other sort of large-scale structures within the cell, which are, for example, a very sort of well-studied one are these cytokinetic rings. And this is fission yeast, so when the yeast cell decides to divide, it makes this ring made of actin and myosin, which ends up contracting and allowing the cell to split in two. So again, there's questions about sort of size and positioning of this ring, which we're not studying. So we're going to focus on filamentous structures. And why this becomes an interesting problem, I think, from a physics perspective, is the fact that, these pictures suggest sort of static structures, but they're not. They're dynamic. They're made of individual parts. They're like polymers made of monomers. And these individual parts are constantly coming onto the filament and falling off. So they're constantly exchanging the components of these structures, and that's true of all of these, are constantly exchanging from being incorporated into the structure and being in the solution, in the cytoplasm. So in light of this turnover, and let me just tell you, this turnover, so this thing is about 6 microns of actin molecules. A micron of actin is about 400 actin polymers, so it's a few thousand actin monomers. And if you put in a drug that sequesters the actin monomers from solution, this thing disappears in under a minute. It's just gone. Okay, so it requires the replenishment, constant replenishment of actin. So they're very dynamic, and similar, I told you the experiments about cutting. So the way to think about it is that cytoskeleton, which is what I'll talk about, is always under this construction. It's constantly, this is a movie I've stolen, and it's going to, it's these cytoskeletal filaments that make up these extended structures in the cell that I'm talking about. This is the process they're constantly undergoing. They're constantly sort of assembling. They're disassembling. Their disassembly is usually caused by other proteins. So here's the assembly of a microtubule. So this is constantly going on, and it's going on at rates that are much faster than the time over which you observe the structure as being stable. And the question is, okay, that's a motor moving on this structure. So the question is, in light of all this dynamics, how does the cell control the length of a filamentous structure?
This is observation.
Oh, sorry, this is simulation, yeah. Based on a lot of observations. And there's a lot of things wrong with this simulation, like almost all absence of any kind of Brownian motion.
So this is not a simulation.
It's a cartoon, sorry, yes. Sorry, it's not even a simulation, it's a cartoon.
So yes. Do filamentary structures have a functional dependence or commonality amongst all the various ones you study?
I don't know. I don't think so. I mean, just yeah. The function I know of these guys is to detect mechanical waves. I mean, sound, and they do that because they get deflected by sound, and then ion channels open up. These are used for transport. So what these are used for is for transport of stuff. That's the technical term that this guy needs, another technical term, to grow and become a big cell. So that's transport. This is swimming. Yeah, so they're different functions. But, yeah. And, but, you know, at least there's lots of studies out there that show that there's a correlation between changing the size and shape of these various structures and affecting the function. So if you cut off one of these legs, this thing swims in circles. That's obvious almost. But it's not clear that the correlate, you know, what to make of those correlations exactly as a physicist. Yes?
And the filament here is like a belt?
Sorry, this one?
Yeah.
Or this, sorry, this?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like a belt that's going to get squeezed. You know? There's also these very faint, you see, these guys, they're this. And these patches are also made of the same stuff, and they're actually contracting and pinching off little pieces of membrane.
They're not.
Pardon? No, they're a branch structure. But actually, and I'll talk about this a little bit later, what's fascinating about this, and this is one of the questions might as well mention here, that I find fascinating, is that all these structures shown here with three arrows are made of the same building blocks, and those building blocks are constantly being exchanged among these structures, yet somehow these structures maintain their functional difference, their maintain differences in shape, and even stay of particular size. So that's cool, and I think it'd be really fun to try to understand how the cell accomplishes this feat of engineering. And so that's kind of the stuff that we're interested in. And like I said, it's all happening. Here's another cartoon taken from a review that shows you kind of the actin filaments at the leading edge. So this is when a cell is crawling and making protrusions. And just as, you know, what I wanted to just, why I brought this up, two things. One is there's all these things, you know, it's not a simple polymerization process because there's all these like proteins and stuff. And I won't talk about any of this. But the bottom line is there's this constant circulation, there's this constant sort of taking off acting and building it back into the structure. So I want to give you the sense that these structures are constantly being there's a constant turnover of the molecular building blocks in the structure. So if you were to follow one, at one instant it'll be in the structure and then in the solution, back in the structure, constant turnover, yet these shapes, if you watch movies, they seem to just sit there and persist. And so that's fun. Okay, so that's kind of maybe not still as precise as most of you would like to, most of you would like me to be. That's sort of the level of precision I'm going to use at this point to define my problem. I'm going to get a little more precise. But before I do that, I want to tell you about kind of one of the favorite models that's out there in the literature, particularly in the biology literature, of how you build a structure of a finite size. And it's very simple. The idea is the following. By some, this is a cell. So this is my cartoon. And it's a movie. Yeah. So this is my version. So I don't have hundreds of thousands of dollars like my friends at Harvard. So this is my... I make cartoons this way. So here's the idea. So I want to make a filament that's of a particular length. And the idea is very simple. It goes by the name of a limiting pool mechanism. Is the cell expresses a limited number of building blocks. Think of these as they are proteins usually. And then these proteins are assembled at some complex. Think of this as a nucleator of the filamentous structure. And the size is simply determined by how many building blocks you have. That's simple. One comes in there. Isn't that cool? Okay. So of course it can be dynamic, which simply means that, you know, these monomers, which in a filamentous structure will typically fall off from the end, which makes the analysis much simpler. You know, they will come on, fall off. But the total number of monomers in this solution will roughly stay constant. All right. So what is the sort of physics or chemistry of this? Well, it's simply saying that this structure grows until the assembly and the disassembly balance out. And now, why do they balance out? Well, they balance out is because as you're assembling the structure, you're depleting the pool of these free monomers. And the rate of assembly, if you think of it as simply being diffusion driven, is dependent on the free concentration, not the total concentration. So the free concentration of monomers decreases, the assembly rate decreases. At some point, it will become, the assembly rate decreases. At some point, it will match the disassembly rate, and now you have a stable length. Why is it stable? Well, at this length, where the assembly rate and the disassembly rate, this is the size, in other words, the length of the filament in my case, at that special size, what happens is there's an equality between how many things get on and how many things get off. And if I make the length a little bigger, well, the disassembly rate wins, so I go back. So it's a stable fixed point of this dynamics. And if, on the other hand, the filament is a little shorter, the assembly wins, and I go again back to my stable fixed point. So it's a very simple, in other words, the model that you find in the biology literature, at least in this beautiful review from a few years back by Tony Hyman, but it's sort of the null model or the simplest model that people start with, is a very simple dynamical system that's based on this very simple physics, right? That the rate of assembly is some constant which contains in it the diffusion constant, I've just thrown it in there, times the concentration of free monomers, but the concentration of free monomers decreases with size because it's the total number of monomers minus the size, right? So that's, I think, beautiful because it's very simple. But it also makes interesting predictions, right? So that's fun. And in fact, it predicts that if I have two cells of different size and the concentration, right, or the concentration of these monomers is the same in the two cells. So now I have another movie. So this was all during a snowstorm in Boston. I decided, oops. So you'll notice I picked my numbers carefully. I was trying to explain it to my son. So you got 4 over V is 8 over 2V. I think everyone's on board with that idea. So now they start assembling. What's going to happen? Well, one monomer gets on. Now you got 3, and here you have 7. And lo and behold, 7 over 2 is greater than 3. Right? So what's going to happen is this guy's going to assemble faster than this guy, even though they start, you know, they're going to start assembling at the same rate, but this one will start assembling faster than this guy. Bottom line is, that's maybe not as interesting, is that when they reach steady state, they will reach the steady state at the same concentration, which means that this cell, which is half the size, will only have 2 monomers, and this one will have twice as many, which is 4. And which also means that the size of this guy will be twice as much as the size of this guy. Or you can run the equations if you prefer. But the bottom line is if this cell with volume V and the volume 2V have these monomers at equal concentration, this guy will grow to twice the length. Because at the end, they have to reach the same concentration of monomers in solution so that the assembly and the disassembly rates are balanced. So as long as you keep the concentration fixed, you get the scaling with size for free.
But you doubled everything but the number of nucleations.
That's right. So I cooked the books here. Yeah, so then you say, oh, but we should have maybe more nucleation sites. Right? I'm not saying that this is how it works. I'm just saying this gives you the scaling for free. And that's one of the reasons why this model is kind of been liked. And I should have said that right away. I was told I should always do this when I teach, and I should do this when I give colloquium, which is, I hate this model, so I'm going to show you why. Well, it's not that I hate it, I think it's good, but I'll show you also how it fails. And then we'll talk about what cells seem to be doing beyond this very simple thing, because this will fail, and it will fail for reasons related to what you just said. Okay, so I'm setting up a bit of a straw man here, but it's the straw man that you'll find in these beautiful reviews, and so it's worth understanding, I think, and it's quite simple. So here's the cartoon. This is directly from the review. I found these drawings a little confusing, but, you know, so I can write an equation, maybe that'll be easier. So if I write assembly, the assembly rate, I won't write the acronym, I've done this once, is the number of molecules, total number of molecules, right? But I'm keeping concentration fixed, so let's write the total number of molecules, the concentration, right, the total concentration, not the free, so this is total concentration times the volume of the cell. That's the total number of molecules. minus, right, the number of molecules, oops, minus the size, right, and it's proportional, so there's a proportionality constant to the free concentration. The free concentration is the total number of molecules minus the size of the structure, and that's the number of molecules in solution, divided by the volume of the cell, that's the concentration. So if you solve this, and you set this equal to this assembly, I think you'll all quickly see that the size scales with the volume of the cell. Volume of cell, volume of cell. So size will scale with the volume of the cell. Or if you like, you can do this. Anyway, so it has this as a built-in feature. And so, in other words, the way this is plotted is if you have a big cell, right, then the slope of this line is going to be, that much smaller because the volume of the cell comes down here, and therefore where it intersects the disassembly line will be at a higher value of the size, and in fact it'll be proportional to the volume of the cell. That's a lot of words for something that's very simple. I think I just made something very simple, very complicated. Okay, moving, any questions? Okay, good. So, experiments. More recent ones. This is actually out of Berkeley, soft matter guy, big hair. Okay. What? He's not at Berkeley. Younger guy. Anyway, it doesn't matter. Matt Good was his postdoc. He's now at Penn. So if you want to hear about this stuff in detail, you should invite him for a colloquium seminar. Dan Fletcher's lab at Berkeley. So they did this very cool experiment. What they did is they have all the material they need to assemble a spindle. I told you a little bit about the spindle, and they put spindles into drops of various size, where they tune the size of the drop. And in big drops, they see self-assembling big spindles, in little drops, little spindles, and you get the scaling. Okay. And all of these will have the same amount of, the same concentration. They're made of the same stuff. You're just enclosing different amounts of stuff, but all at the same concentration. So that's sort of a demonstration of this idea, and a very beautiful experiment. There are others in cells that people have done. There's a very beautiful by Cliff Brangwyn over at Princeton, where he's looked at the size of nucleoli, which is another kind of drop-like structure within the nucleus, and has looked at how the size scales with the size of the nucleus and found this direct scaling. And he's done some very nice perturbations where he changes the size of the nucleus and looks at what happens to the size of the nucleolus, and that also kind of all fits into this very simple picture. So there's some data out there that suggests that this is not just a fantasy. Okay, so that's great. That's sort of point number one, is that there's some structures in cells that, at least when they're assembled in vitro, it seems as though the size of these structures is simply controlled by the availability of the sort of building blocks within the cytoplasm, the amount you have. That's point number one. Point number two is that, well, it's very rare that in cells you assemble only one structure. So like I said, you might, like this is a beautiful example, you're not assembling one of these cilia, you're assembling a bunch of them, and they're all made of the same building blocks. And it's critical to your hearing that all these cilia have very specific lengths. They can't have random lengths. Okay, they have to have very specific lengths, and what more, they have to have this very sort of this spatial organization of these cilia, where the little ones follow the big ones, follow the bigger ones, follow the bigger ones. You need that. If you screw that up, you can't hear, or you it's impaired. It's not as simple as you can't hear. So, so the question then becomes: so here's sort of a cartoon. How is it that you can control multiple structures within the same cytoplasm? Okay, so going back to my silly cartoons that you may or may not like, it's like asking the following problem in the toy model that I've introduced you to. What if I have now two sites of nucleation and I start assembling two filaments? What's the end result? Well, Well, you know, at first you have a large concentration, so the rate of addition is going to be bigger than the rate of things coming off the filament. So you're going to have sort of a flux, you know, there's going to be a growth of this guy and a growth of this guy, right? And it's going to grow until the monomers, the blocks that are in solution, reach some special critical concentration, right? But now, what if this guy is, and this happens for real, I'll show you some examples, is assembling, helping assemble the filament at a rate that's faster than this guy. They will have different critical concentrations. So which critical concentration will win? What's the end result when you have this kind of competition for the same pool of monomers? And again, the reason I'm bringing this up is this happens all the time. I should really, you know, this is not good, but like here, you have different structures, like I said, and they're all made of the same monomers, and they're assembled by different protein factors. So they're assembled by different stuff that nucleates and sometimes it aids in assembly. So they have intrinsically different rates. How is it that you can maintain different structures within the same cytoplasm, within the same box, while they're exchanging monomers, right? Does the question make sense? So, okay, so what's going to happen here? So I'm not going to ask people to guess, because last few times I've done this at audiences, lots of soft matter people, everyone guessed right, which made me feel very bad because it took me 6 months. So I won't make myself feel bad again. So I'll just tell you the answer. But if you know the answer, good for you. Just kidding. So like I said, what's going to happen is if I follow the length versus time, bottom left, you're going to see both filaments growing. And what I've indicated here is that the left guy is assembling at a rate that's higher than the right, than the green guy. So this K prime is higher. And that's due to some protein doing something interesting. And I won't get into exactly what that is, but let's just assume such a situation. So you're going to have both of these guys growing. And oops, I don't want to do that. And here's what happens. At some point, they both grow to a particularly long length, and then the one that's longer wins out, takes up all the monomers, and this guy gets nothing. So it's winner take all. And maybe that's not surprising. So therefore, if I look at the distribution of lengths, the length of this filament will essentially be small. There will be an exponential distribution. And on the other hand, this guy will have a nicely defined length with a peaks distribution. So I'm just saying you can run the math, and that's the outcome. So in other words, if you have two nucleating sites competing for the same pool, only one will grow in any substantial amount. So if the only thing you have controlling size is a finite number of blocks, which I just showed you examples of in biology, right? So there's got to be more.
Do they have different rate constants?
Right, so this constant here, K prime, is different for the blue and the green guy. Yeah. That's why this guy assembles. Yeah.
I don't understand how that brown guy at the end of this tail knows whether it started from blue or from green.
It doesn't. It keeps falling off and it can go here.
But then K prime becomes independent, eventually becomes independent of.
Yeah. So K prime is something that should, if it were just diffusion to capture, it should only depend on the diffusion constants of the red guys.
Yeah, and attachment.
And attachment, right. But, right, so the and the way in the examples that I know of in biology this works is really that the attachment is affected by this protein, and actually the red guys are coming on here.
Ah, okay.
Okay, so if that's...
I see. Not that this.
Yeah. So these guys are being attached faster by the blue guy than the green guy. And the specific examples are in cells. These guys that form these filament structures are called formins. And there's many different formins, and they all attach at different rates. Human cells have 15 different formins. Yeast cells have 2 different formins. Every cell on this planet has these formins, and there's a bunch of them, anywhere from 2 to 15. And one of the ways that they differ is that these attachment rates are different. Okay. Why intelligent designer intelligently created them in this way, we don't really know, obviously, but they are there. So that's okay. So if you want to write equations, this is what I was just alluding to. So, you know, the addition is really happening here molecularly, and you have two different constants. And of course, the reason that the growth of this guy is coupled to this guy is that they're drawing monomers from the same solution. So the total number of monomers that are free in the pool is the total minus the length of one structure plus the length of the second structure. So you have this very simple coupling that, you know, here's a simulation. If you run it, there's a time. Both of these structures started at zero time and zero length. They both grow up quickly to some finite length, and then the faster one just takes over, and this guy loses all its monomers. Okay. If you make the rates very close to each other, then you see large fluctuations along the way in length. If you make them identical, then you can actually show that you have the only thing that's fixed is the sum of these two lengths and not the lengths themselves, and then the distributions of lengths becomes flat. So the size is completely unspecified if you're competing for the monomers and you're using nucleators and assemblers that are running at the exact same rate. So then there's no size control because the distribution is completely flat. But if one is faster, that one takes up all the monomers. And actually, there's some data out there, recent experiments from Dave Kovar's lab at Chicago, where they were able to do this in cells, make all the actin go to one structure, in this case, these rings, in another case, go to just the patches, essentially, with some cables. And what they were really doing is that they were messing around with the rates of addition of this guy versus that guy. And the way they were doing that is by changing the amount, it gets into details, but changing the amount of a protein that binds to actin, and then this complex more readily sort of assembles on these formins and not on ARP23. So these are the nucleators for the two different structures. So they could kind of toggle between these structures by messing around with profilin, overexpressing them, or messing around with actin. Okay, so this kind of competition does seem to also exist. Maybe not, you know. And here, in the wild-type cell, they all seem to coexist. So we would not ever predict this based on the simple model. We would say it would have to be this or this, depending on which one is faster. Does that make sense? Okay. So here's a summary of this whole thing. And I'm not going to do any of the math, but actually this is fairly simple. Stuff which you can work out in detail with pen and paper. So if you have, imagine you can even do like a bunch of nucleators, and the shape tells you if these are growing faster than these, assembling faster than these. So you have initial very fast phase, which happens on a time that's order one compared to the number of monomers. Everything assembles into long filaments. Then over time of order n, when you look at the dynamics of the length, there's like a diffusion plus drift kind of dynamics, where over time of order n, which n is the number of monomers, the fast ones take all the monomers, these guys go away. And then there's a diffusion time, which is of order n squared, where the monomers exchange between these guys, and that's the steady state. So that's the full description of this very simple model. And it raises a question, right? So it raises the question of, and that's sort of what I want to end with, is how is it then that, for instance, in yeast, the example we studied, there are multiple cables, they're roughly all the same size, about five or six of them, they're all made of actin. We know that the actin is constantly being exchanged between these cables and the cytoplasm. How is it that these guys stay at a constant length? One answer could be that it's not a steady state. Right? One answer could be, well, these are metastable states. This goes away in about an hour. And, you know, it might be just we don't sitting there long enough to observe the kinds of dynamics, late stage dynamics that I described theoretically. So that's one possibility. And like I said, the role of these cables is to transport little secretory vesicles. I have a movie here just so you can kind of get a sense. It's showing you in seconds. It's a little hard to see, I apologize, but you should see little dots. Those are the secretory vesicles, and they eventually make their way up these cables. They move a few microns per second. This is about 5 microns in length, and they're traveling along the cable. And so you want to know how the length of this is controlled. And this is where we got into the story. This is why why I really got into this whole business, is that a friend of mine sitting in the biology department, he told me, something that I thought was kind of miraculous. He told me, well, I found this protein, and if I delete it, these guys become very long. And that made no sense to me. And maybe, why didn't it make any sense to me? Well, I said, well, what does this protein do? Well, it says, oh, well, it hooks up to this protein machine that does the assembly, and it clogs it up. It makes it run slower. And okay, but that can't control length, right? Because all that's going to do is it's going to effectively sort of change the rate at which you're adding things, right? If you think about it, it can't be a length controller. So anyway, so the way I was thinking about this at the time, which got me excited, was the following, and maybe I should have pointed this out. So what's going on here, right? So you're assembling a filament, and think of any internal structure in the cell, and you're usually assembling them with units that are a few nanometers in size. A protein is like it's a ball of about 5 nanometers in diameter, right? If no one else tells you otherwise and they say protein, just think of sort of something that has roughly the density of water, that's a sphere, and it's 5 nanometers. Maybe Shor doesn't like this, he's thought about protein folding, but anyway. So that's a protein, right? These proteins and cells, they only know about each other when they're only a couple of nanometers apart. There's no electrostatics. It's all screened, lots of salt. Yeah, okay. So you got these balls that only know about each other when they hit each other. So they only know about each other at nanometer scale. And now they're coming and they're hooking up and growing something that's microns in scale, 3 orders of magnitude larger. And somehow they read out that micron scale. They know about the micron scale because they'll stop. They'll stop growing at the micron scale. And now what this friend of mine tells me is I take another little thing, another little ball that's a few nanometers, I knock it out, and all of a sudden this thing, instead of being 5 microns, is 10 microns. So what this just makes, you know, so to me that was a cool question. Like, how could a small protein like that affect the size of something that's 5 microns? Does that make sense? Okay, and so, and then later we realized, but it also answers the question of how you can have multiple structure. And the idea is that this protein that controls this so-called SMI1 that does this does something very interesting. It actually gets transported, this is the cable, it actually gets transported to the protein guy that builds the cable along on these motors. So I showed you the motor early on. These are myosins, they move on actin. So here's the idea. Okay. So this chair, all right, this is best. Sorry, this chair is the thing that's assembling the monomers, right? And it's building a filament. All right. Okay, building a filament. All right. So these active monomers are being added on. Okay, I'm not going to jump on the table. But imagine me jumping on the table. That's one of these SMI1 molecules. When it binds to the actin, it zips along the actin and comes here and clogs up the builder. This provides feedback on the length. Because more table I have, more of these guys can come down, zip along. Imagine zipping is really fast, they don't fall off, which is the case. And so the rate at which they're coming here and clogging up this guy that's building the structure, that rate is going to increase with length. Does everyone see that? Because think of it, what I'm doing is I'm building a highway, and every little step of the highway, there's an entrance to the highway, and in this, all these molecules are coming into these entrances, and they're all going here, so the rate at which they're going to arrive here is just going to increase with the size of the highway. I'm looking at Paul because we sat in this committee together. And maybe you don't remember, but for like 2 months, you gave me a hard time about a problem I tried to put on the generals and just wouldn't believe any of it.
It wasn't this one.
What? It wasn't this one. It was another one that led to super diffusion. I remember it to this day because I was like so frustrated. I couldn't convince it. Anyway, so the idea is this provides length feedback. So as the cable goes longer, the growing guy will spend less time in the on state when it's adding monomers. And this can stabilize a length independent of depleting the monomer pool. So your monomer pool doesn't have to get depleted at all, but this active transport of the damper molecule would lead to a stable length. Now, how cool is that? So anyway, so I was very excited. So what we decided, so essentially my friend kind of had this whole story. He said, So he said, all these things damp. I said, well, if they're just diffusing and coming to this guy and binding and clogging it up, there's no way they're providing any information about the length. I was like, oh, I forgot to tell you something. They only get there when we do motor. And in fact, if we disable motor transport, these things also overgrow. I was like, well, why didn't you tell me that right away? That's important how they get there. It's like, why is it important? Because, you know, I'm a biochemist. I just know they bind and they block activities. Like, no. This provides a mechanism. And so then you can turn, you know, once you have that insight, you can turn it into theory. Here's a simpler version of it. So this is the guy that's adding, that's the assembly. That's called a foramen. These particles are getting on the filament, coming here, binding for a while, falling off. But the longer the filament, the more that more come, the less, on average, assembly occurs. And therefore, you get a situation where with length, the assembly goes down because of this mechanism. If you assume just that this assembly is constant, again, you will have a stable, steady state at a specific length. And this length now can happen. This can be selected even though you're not depleting the pool or anything like that. The feedback doesn't come from a finite monomer pool. It comes from this active transport of a damper. Does that make sense? And the cool thing about this guy is okay, so you can turn this into some mathematics, for those of you who like mathematics. So what you can imagine is a kind of a master equation type setup, and you can delineate a few very simple things. One is there's assembly, that's simply adding a monomer. And then, this is the key thing, this assembly can be turned on or off. It's off when one of these guys gets transported here. And therefore, the rate at which it goes off, I call that K on, because it's the rate at which this gets on, sorry about that, is proportional to the length. And that provides the feedback and leads to a stable length. The off rate, so that's the rate of this guy falling off the monomer, that of course makes the off state in terms of growing the filament turn into non-state, that's fixed. That's just the molecular interaction between these two guys, it just falls off. And then of course there's also dissociation, the monomers falling off. So you can put this all in to a master equation, you can solve it, and then you can actually compute the effect of deleting SMI1, which means if you delete SMI1, you never go into this off phase, and of course then what happens is the filament becomes longer, and in fact if you use numbers and you assume that the only thing that makes the filament stop growing at that point is the finite monomer pool with the kind of numbers we have for the amount of actin and so forth in yeast, you get that the length is roughly double, which is roughly what we see in experiments when we collect a lot of these long cable lengths. It's not quite doubling, but it's good enough at the level I think we've described it. So now we're trying to do more detailed experiments because we have interesting ways of tuning the experimental system. What we can do is we can tune the interaction between this damper and the assembler. Right? So the damper gets on the assembler and it sticks there and then it falls off. If we tune that interaction, we can tune how much on average time the damper spends on the assembler. If we make the interaction very weak, it'll fall off right away and it won't be as effective at blocking. So the weaker you make this interaction, the longer the cables you expect, and that's what we found. So this is a much nicer experiment where we've quantified, or my colleagues quantified, the various mutations and how they affect, how well they bind to this guy, and then when we put those mutants into the cell, we also see an overgrowth of cables. And you know, the data is still not good enough for us to actually try to test anything in detail of the experiments, other than at least qualitatively we see that if we make these mutations, which simply make this binding weaker, which in the model means that this off rate becomes bigger, that's the rate at which this bimolecular interaction falls apart. If we do that, we see longer cables and as they do in the experiment. So that's where we're at right now.
And how about disruption, spontaneous disruption of these blockers in transit before they arrive to the builder?
So we don't see that. And the reason, well, it gets, yeah, is don't see this, they're actually transported by on vesicles that have multiple motors. So what we think is going on is that one motor falls off, the other latches on. So it's like this whole vesicle filled with these guys. But then they can fall off the vesicle. So you bring up a good point. We haven't considered that. Let me just be, that's...
I would guess that if the filament is long enough, then eventually it becomes inevitable.
That you can't use this anymore, right. Absolutely.
And then you will have equilibrium between absorption and desorption.
So what we really would like to do, and we have a new postdoc who's going to try and do this, is reconstitute this in vitro. We can't push it that hard in vivo. And then we'll try to see some of these effects. But absolutely, So this idea that you can control length. So if there's anything I want to, what I love about this is anyway. So maybe some of you have heard about these filaments, and maybe you've even heard about the fact that there are these motors that walk along the filaments, and they do various things. One of the things that usually we hear about is like myosin and actin. They provide these contractile forces, and you get interesting kind of activities from that. Or the kinesins, they're usually thought of as transporters. So they transport materials. But now I'm telling you something new, which is that these motors walking on filaments also provide feedback that allows for the regulation of the length of the substrate on which they're walking. And this was not, and we discovered this in the actin case, but before that, it was discovered by a guy named Joe Howard, who's now at Yale, in the kinesin case. And what Joe found is that you can have kinesins walking on microtubules, and when they end up at the end of the microtubules, they depolymerize the microtubules. So now you have a situation where the longer the microtubule, the more depolymerization you have, and that also can stabilize a length. And they've shown that in vitro. So this is a beautiful in vitro system. What you can see here is the microtubule fluorescently labeled. This is a chymograph, so time goes down this way. I'm sorry, this got cut off. This is 4 microns, this is a few minutes. And when you add this kinesin, look what's going on. One end, which is not the end that the kinesin walks on, it's growing shorter, slowly but surely. And the other end is also, but look, the speed at which it's decreasing is constantly changing. The rate of length change here is given by the slope. So there's some initial period of loading, but look, big slope, little slope. Small filament, less depolymerization. Long filament, more depolymerization. Very clear. And that can lead to length control. So it's this kind of mechanism again. You have the walkers, they're walking on a filament, they depolymerize. Now if you assume that the assembly is happening at a constant rate, this assembly in a simple model here is linear in the filament length. Again, you will have a set point at which you have a stable length, and so this can serve as the control of length. So this is a situation where depolymerization is length dependent. The bottom line is, I'll skip this, it's another example, but the bottom line is that if you, in general, if you want to control the size, here I'm talking about length of filamentous structure, you need some kind of feedback, either of assembly decreasing with length or assembly increasing, disassembly increasing with length. That's the take-home message. The finite monomer pool is just one such mechanism, because in that case, the assembly decreases with length, because as you make the length bigger, there are fewer monomers in the pool. Okay, but that mechanism has problems because it cannot, by virtue of the coupling through the finite monomer pool, it cannot control the sizes of individual multiple structures. So you need another feedback that does not depend on the finite monomer pool, which allows you to decouple the different structures from each other, and then you're stuck with the problem of you're maybe kicking the can down the road, you're stuck with the problem of having a finite number of nucleators and putting them in different positions in the cell, which they do. But then we can start trying to figure out how they do that.
But this one doesn't depend on the length of the cell.
Ah, yes. So this is how to... So then you can start asking the question, If one of these rates also depends, because they're all dependent on concentrations of different things, that could introduce a size dependence. So I have not shown you that this will produce... Okay, what I've shown you is that with the rates that we measure, this produces a filament of the size of roughly the yeast. What I haven't shown you is that if I had a yeast that was twice as big, that the filament would be twice as big. We don't have that experiment. And we actually don't see... We can cook up scenarios where that's true, because we can cook up scenarios where that's true by saying, oh, if the SMI1 concentration, if the number of SMI1s is the same in the bigger cell, the concentration will go down. So one of those rates will scale proportionally, and then the length will scale proportionally. So we can cook up scenarios, but we don't have any evidence, so I'm not presenting any. So the reason I presented, sorry, this might have been a little convoluted, the reason I wanted to show you the scaling with size is that was the best evidence we have thus far of this finite monomer pool operating. And so what I wanted to say, that's great, that's fine, but it's clearly not enough when you have multiple structures for just simple physics reasons. And indeed, when we look at some of these structures which were the multiples, we find other feedbacks. So anyway, that was maybe convoluted logic, but it seemed kind of reasonable when I put it together in my head. So you had Rob here. This is something that Rob and I did. We like to make tables. So we actually looked at all the literature out there on control of length of different filamentous structures, and it turns out there's at least six different ones, including the finite monomer pool, that people have proposed. And the fun part is you can actually do the math and compute the steady state distributions of lengths of all of these. You can obviously compute the means. And so one of the things we're trying to get people interested in, and you know, we're doing some of these experiments, is trying to use these ideas, maybe not these specific formulas, but the general idea of kind of saying, okay, well, let's carefully measure distributions of lengths and then try to get rid of some of these models, simply by comparing the length distributions of the measurement and the ones that come from theory. At least try to zero in on some of the possible models. So that's one of the ways that I feel like maybe as a theorist that we can contribute. So I think I've talked enough, so let me just conclude, and I think I've said all this. I hope I've convinced you that this question of how the size of internal structures in cells is controlled is interesting. And again, it's this age-old question, I think, in physics, at least the parts of physics I come from, which is how is it a system of interacting particles when interactions are local, nanometer scale, produces something, a structure that's micron in scale, that's stable, in light of constant turnover? That's the question, right? And you're not allowed to use long-range interactions to stabilize, right? Because there are none here, at least not in the traditional sense of electrostatics, even though you can think about other ones like maybe elasticity and stuff. So that's the general question. And then, you know, the way that a lot of the community has thought about this is in the context of depleting a finite monomer pool, which, you know, does lead to a stable structure, does lead to scaling, but really does not do this. So this should not be there. This does not happen. If you have two nucleators, you get two structures. You get two structures, but what's missing is the fact that this exchange between this guy and this guy costs no free energy, so their sizes do a random walk. And that's no good for controlling size. And then what I've at least hoped to have kind of given you is a couple of fun examples where, in fact, motors, so things that expend free energy, active, you know, sort of things, moving on these filaments allow for, because they're moving on the filaments and delivering either a depolymerization signal or a signal that says, please stop polymerizing, because the signal is transmitted along the microtubule, you get feedback on the length, and that allows for, again, a stable length, but without the use of depleting a pool. And as I said, this is kind of the thing I'm most excited about right now, because our friends at the University College of London have found a molecule kind of like SMI1. If they make mutants, this is hearing cells with these cilia of many different lengths. The deletion of one of these leads to all the cilia having the same length, just one little protein. And again, you know, that was the first thing we asked, and it turns out that's what they see when they study this further, is that these molecules are actually transported by motors. So we think something very similar, we're betting on the fact that something very similar is happening in these guys. What we cannot start to imagine is how do you get the graded structure? How is it that you get long ones and short ones? Well, so we can cook something up, but it's just everything I've tried seems completely implausible to me because we know that the molecules that are building these and that are building the short ones, they're exchanging. Right? So they're all in the common cytoplasm, and maybe it's cooked up by initial condition, you're saying, by setting up nucleators in a very specific way. Maybe.
Well, yeah. If the short nucleator binds more strongly to the inhibitor than the long one, then that will fix your problem, right?
That would, but there's no evidence of that. I mean, structurally, we don't know of any difference between the short and the so far. They haven't discovered anything. So it's a mystery. But maybe something like that will allow us to get at this. Okay, so let me just thank the people that did all the work. Actually, this theory project started with a student that. So a few years now, I've been trying to teach biologists theory with sometimes good success. One of my biology theory students at Woods Hole was Thibaut, who's at Institute Curie. He's a cell biologist, and he did all the initial sort of computational studies. In fact, this was so fun because I asked him, check out what happens when you have two nucleators in the finite monomer pool, and then he comes after 2 days, is like, I've done it. What do you mean you've done it? Well, I learned how to do MATLAB. I learned all this stuff. I learned how to write stochastic simulations. Here's the results. And what I see is that the lengths are oscillating. They weren't oscillating. They were undergoing anticorrelated fluctuations. But over finite time trace, they did look like oscillations. So that's impossible. It's a linear system. There can't be any oscillations. You know, Pat, not really. But you know, that was good work, Thibaut. Why don't you go back another 2 days? Come back when you've got the code fixed. So he comes back after 2 days. It's like, well, it looks like it's not real oscillations, but they are doing this crazy stuff. It's like, that makes sense. So anyway, this went on for about a week or so, and to his credit, being a good scientist, he didn't believe the old fart. He went ahead and keep doing it, and he convinced me this is a real thing. And then we started thinking about it, and most of the story you heard came out of that. His TA was my graduate student, Lishi, who has been instrumental. And then Bruce is the guy in MCB at Brandeis who does all the yeast experiments. Julian is a physics student who works in Bruce's lab. We try to always have sort of physics, and even though sometimes our physics students do experiments and sometimes the biologists do theory, but it's all good. Rob and I have also had fun with this stuff. And then more recently, my friend, who is actually an applied mathematician up at Columbia, he's actually shown me there's some very cool results from queuing theory, which allow you to do some pretty mathematics with these things, which we've had fun. And it's all been great. And thanks for your attention. Sorry I went a little over time.
Okay.
Any questions? I thoroughly confused everyone. I'm sorry.
And go to the next slide. Do you know how's the length distribution of that cell?
So this is all in one cell, but you mean the distributions of lengths of these guys?
The length of the lower.
Excuse me?
The length distribution of each
row. Oh, so if I look at the small ones, how much distribution and length there is, I don't know. So we haven't looked at that yet. Yeah. But you know, my sense is they're fairly tightly distributed. And there's another organism in a different lab at UC Davis that we're working with, and that one is actually, I think, going to be a more manageable system. That's Giardia, you know, the thing you're not supposed to put in your stomach, like why you're not supposed to drink water when you go hiking. Right? So Giardia has four flagella. Actually, it has four pairs. Wrong. Three pairs. Long, medium, and short. And you look, the medium, let's say, is 4 microns, the long is about 8, and the short is about 3 microns. And you look at one Giardia, another Giardia, another Giardia, it's always 3, 4, 8, and that 3, 4, 8 is plus minus, let's say, 20%. And so, and they're all made of tubulin, and this tubulin is exchanging, you know, so how do you set that up? So there we have more. We don't have an answer, but it's at least three, not, you know, this guy. And this is mouse, so doing genetics takes a long time. And that's, you know, well, that's an organism for which there's no genetics. But you know, this guy's brave and trying to develop the genetics so we can, you know, play around with different molecules. Yes, David.
How about your example of Chlamydomonas, where yes. the structures that are being regulated are outside, not inside?
Ah, no, but they're inside. So they're protrusions from the outside. So it's really like that. And there's the thing, the key structural element is a microtubule. Actually, it's a, yeah. And there, Wallace Marshall has shown there's a transport of tubulin. So this is a situation where you have little trains that are bringing these guys here. And actually, these are kinesin-driven, and there's dynein-driven trains that bring him the back. And the number of trains, for God knows what reason, seems to be constant. So when they get long, the rate that the trains arrive at goes down, and you get a fixed length.
But has the other one know when you cut it?
Ah, so that we think is a finite pool thing, but we don't know. So if you cut this, we think now these trains are going to bring stuff faster, so it's going to bleed off these guys. But that's a guess. But there you can do some cool experiments because, well, Wallace has done some very cool experiments. And actually, a model that says what I just said, that it's train delivery plus finite pool, he can actually, in a recent paper, he actually computed the length fluctuations during this process, not just the average. And he can predict, he can actually describe that with no adjustable parameters, I believe, just from this dynamics. So it's kind of, that's a very well.
Is that true of all flagellates, or
so this mechanism of trains delivering stuff?
Are all flagella that structure?
No. Well, I mean, certainly not E. coli. You know, so that's a totally different thing. That's not tubulin or anything. That's flagellin that does something. I mean, there it's the length of E. coli flagella. I don't know actually much about that question. Yeah. But not all stuff that sticks outside the cells is like this, right? I mean, these are cilia that are usually microtubule-based protrusions. Then all the kinds of protrusions that you see when cells are moving, those are actin. And those are probably, you know, there's no, I don't think there's like a length thing there going on, because that's kind of this sort of structure that's not of well-defined length. But the cilia, they always kind of grow to this, these cilia always grow to the same length. And you cut one and it continues to swim, and the poor thing is swimming in circles. Eventually it figures it out. So, that's funny. So which paper should I read?
Yeah, that I didn't prepare to tell you, by the way.
Okay, good. I knew it. This is not the first time we've had this dance, you and I, right?
Of course.
Yeah. That's why I didn't want to talk about chromatin last time. Anyways, so.
But you have two models in which one in one feedback provided by the pool of free monomers, and the other one feedback is provided by the lens of your antenna.
Yes.
The fact that the second model you use some additional molecule, it's not so important. You can use also building blocks.
Yeah. In fact, that's probably what goes on here. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. So therefore, there should be some region where one feedback mechanism crosses over to that.
Yes.
Do you observe it somewhere?
No.
Why?
Cells, not much control. I think you're right. And if I were a good theorist, I would have already calculated this, and I might try to do it as soon as I get home. So in other words, I don't know, I haven't sat down and figured out for yeast when this would happen, which I can. We never see it. I've been kind of trying, you know, spending all my energy trying to get this thing reconstituted in vitro so that we can easily explore all the regimes, right? And so I just don't, I suspect you're absolutely right. I have thought about it, but I just don't know when it happens, and I've never observed it. We've never observed it in cells.
Okay.
Yeah. But I think that's a good.
The paper you should read is Delbrück.
Delbrück?
Yes.
Oh, the old antenna thing.
Yes, the old antenna.
Not your antenna thing. But that was like how to speed up reactions. Anyway, we can talk about it.
It's the same.
It's the same, you think? Even though that's diffusive and not direct. Okay. All right. Thanks all for coming.
Yeah.